on this gorgeous sunny spring Sunday. And welcome to our special guests who are here. We're so excited that you are part of our program today. Everybody, please stand and we will sing our opening song, which is just perfect for a day like today. We come together to subscribe to our email, subscribe to our YouTube channel so that we can get lots of followers, because that way we get our message out to the world. The Unity Movement offers ideas for full and abundant living, and we draw on the teachings of Jesus, who we consider our primary way shower and our example. And we honor that there is wisdom in faith traditions all over the planet. There is wisdom to be found in story and in song and poetry. And every person has the right to choose their own life path, their own spiritual path. All are welcome here. All are worthy here, and all most certainly are celebrated here. We begin our service today in a time of grounding prayer. So I invite you to close your eyes if that is comfortable for you. As we begin with gratitude that we are on the traditional land of the Kakite First Nation, and it is on this land that we play, we learn, we do our work, and we live. We give thanks that we can come together today in this place as well as in a virtual environment. It is a reminder for us of our connectedness one with another. We affirm that there is only one power, that presence, that power, that creative energy that is understood by many names. Some call that power God, others Allah, Yahweh, Creator, Quantum. By whatever our understanding for that creative and loving and intelligent power that forms us, we affirm that we are one power, and we are one power within that power, that there is no spot that God is not. And so we use that power within us, which is part of that energy, to bless all the peoples of this world, regardless of all the labels that threaten to divide us. We awaken to our oneness and affirm that we are one. We send a blessing of love, of peace, of contentment, of abundance to every person on this planet. We are so grateful that we can be here today. And so it is. I'll share the daily word with you today, for me first. Today's word is joy. I carry joy in my heart. My many happy experiences and memories may lead me to feel joyful, but I know that they are not the source of my joy. One of my divine gifts, joy is part of my spiritual identity and is as close to me as my next breath. Joy wells up and spills over within me when I bring awareness to my spiritual nature and to my oneness with all which is good and all that is life. It is an attitude I hold in mind and a feeling I hold in my heart. The happiness I feel in life depends on my allowing my inner wellspring of joy to come forth. I nurture joy by maintaining a regular prayer practice that enhances my awareness of God, and by making time for things that make me happiest. I go into the world grateful for the joy that resides within me and my gift to share generously. And from Isaiah chapter 55, verse 12, "For you shall go out in joy and be led back in peace." I invite you just to listen to the words of this song.
Hallelujah. A word of
I chose that song today because Daniel Neymar, who is the person who wrote that song, wrote it as part of a performance for the Parliament of World Religions several years ago. And he spoke about the reason he wrote it with the words, "My God," because he wanted it to be inclusive for anyone, regardless of their definition of "My God." So whatever your understanding is of God, that song can be sung. And so for me, it's just perfect for today. So about 3 weeks ago, maybe 6 weeks ago, a gentleman came to the door and spoke to Greta and said, "We might be interested in sharing and renting some space." And Greta gave Ali my phone number, and we connected. And so for the last month, during the month of Ramadan, our space has been blessed in so many ways by a whole new community that has been here on the weekends, Friday nights and Saturdays, or sometimes Saturdays and Sundays, as during Ramadan, they break their fast at the end of the day with an iftar meal. And we, as a board, were invited to join, and then actually as a community, we're invited to join their iftar meals. And several of us came last night, and some of us came for a special meal a few weeks ago. And what seems to be true, and I'm going to get all verklempt, is that this is like just a beautiful marriage, because we have these warm and beautiful people here who are using our space in a way that is so additive and generative and generous. And I am very, very excited for this new relationship. And so one of the things I asked Ali right from the start is, would you be willing to come and share a little bit about your community and about your beliefs and about your dreams and like all of it? Because we actually don't know that much in our Unity community and probably in most Christian-based communities. Oh, I am actually all for that. And so, in that wonderful spirit of generosity, he said yes, and then Salim said yes, and Adiba, and all of the rest of you and your beautiful energy just warms my heart. And so, in the interest of not completely making a silly goof of myself here, I want to invite Salim to come up and introduce everyone. Well, when you will. And I am so, so glad. You have no idea what a blessing it feels like, and I know to be true, that you are all part of our community too.
Thank you very much.
Get rid of my mask because it's much better to see people. So normally when we start, we say Salaam Alaikum. Salaam Alaikum means peace upon you. And then that's our greeting. We bring peace and we want to spread peace. So that's what we want to do. Rona, I can't thank you enough. For me, the word joy, that's what brings us here. We are really, we are happy. We are full of joy that you invited us and you accepted us, and when we reached out to you looking for a space. So thank you very much for your generosity, hospitality, and we really appreciate you. Thank you, and everybody here. So just, we are neighbors, and it's really good for us to connect with each other. And then that's what we are trying to do, to make us neighbors as the Kurdish community. We started a little foundation called the Norisi Foundation of Canada. And Norisi is one of the Kurdish scholars and thinker who was detained, persecuted because of his belief and because of his ethnicity and nationality. We felt that for us, as a member of a minority community divided in many places, it would be really good for us to use that name to identify us, as many of us were persecuted and had to flee to come to safety here. So what I would do, we normally start by the greeting and then a recitation from the Holy Quran. And the recitation is to give us blessing for the gathering that we have right here. And then we will follow that with land acknowledgement, because we really want to be grateful to the custodians of the land and acknowledge them. We tell you a little bit about the Nursi Foundation and why we started it. And then we'll talk about the Kurdish community and Kurdistan, what it is. I promise that it will be brief. And then we'll talk about the overview of the Kurdish community here in BC and in Canada in general. And then we'll talk about pillars of Islam, and then we'll end. If there are any questions, we would love either during the discussion or after we join you when you are breaking here. And we brought some of the sweets, Kurdish sweets, with us. Please try them when you are done. Thank you. So I invite my colleague Amjad to come and do a recitation of the Quran. He has a really lovely voice, much better than mine. But we are all fasting, so sometimes our throats are dry. Amjad, please come and join.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم آمن الرسول بما أنزل إليه من ربه والمؤمنون كل آمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله لا نفرق بين أحد من رسله وقالوا سمعنا وأطعنا غفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها لها ما كسبت وعليها ما اكتسبت ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين
Thank you, Amjad. The translation I put in there, but it's really important for me to say it actually. When we say the messenger, we refer to Muhammad, and we normally, when we mention his name, we say Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, peace and blessing be upon him. So the messenger, in the Quran it says that the messenger believe in what has been sent down to him from the Lord, Creator, Allah, God, so do the believers. Everyone believes in God and his angels, his books, and his messengers. We do not differentiate between any of his messengers. So for us, Muhammad and Jesus are the same. And when we say creator, we refer to the one God, and basically, for us, God has 99 names that we refer to him, and one of them is Allah. So that's really what brings us together, and many times For people, when they show differences, they actually don't go to the essence of the religion, which is to bring people together and to show what they are. And in it, basically, for us, in the Quran, it says that God only assigns a soul something it can cope. So God will never ask us to do something that's beyond our capacity. It's actually within our control and all this. And that's the essence of us, of the religion. In the Quran, in another verse, it says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. So in this verse, Allah says, O mankind, we have created you from a male and a female, and set you up as nation and tribes, so that you may recognize and cooperate with one another. The noblest among you with Allah is that the one who best performs his duty. So can you imagine this? This is actually what we believe in. And it's really not different what Rona was saying. So the source of the religion for us, it's the same. And we really, when we reached out to you, we were really hoping to find a place that has the same belief as we do, who would welcome us and give us a space, because we were really struggling to find a space. So now, of course, for us, coming from our own land and we were uprooted, I really want us to take a moment to acknowledge that the Kaikait First Nation and other Coast Salish people, we acknowledge them for whose traditional and unceded territories we live, we learn, we play, and we do our work. It's an acknowledgement. We have been forced out of our land, and when we come to somebody else's land as settlers, we really want to acknowledge them and appreciate them. I will invite Ali to come, because he was the one who connected us to you guys, to say some words.
Today is the last day of the month of Ramadan. It's now our great pleasure to thank all of you. We would like to thank Rona, Slave, board members, and the entire community at Unity of New Westminster. We appreciate your support, your hospitality in providing this amazing place. We appreciate your understanding, dedication, and time. All of that means so much to our Kurdish community. We appreciate your open-mindedness. We are very sure without your support we couldn't make our gathering. Our team tried their best to keep this place clean and quiet. We tried their best to respect our neighbors. And we took care about the staff and the items. If something that happened, we are sorry about that, and we'll try to fix it. For us, I think it's a start point. We will be happy to continuing our work with Unity of New Westminster and Norsi Foundation. Thank you.
Of course, he was speaking for all of us, and to be honest with you, we were looking for a space, and some of us got together and we felt the need for our community to get together over something, for faith to bring them together and culture. And we felt it's really important for us to do that, and of course space is number one. For us, we need to find the space to bring the community together. We looked for many spaces. We actually went to mosque and other. We couldn't find a place that's suitable for us. And when Ali told us that the Unity of New Westminster is willing to give us the space, that could be a consideration. Without any hesitation, we all said, please go ahead and have a conversation with them. We would love to use the space, and we would be honored to use their space. So our foundation started with a mission that we want to create opportunities for Canadian Kurds to embrace their faith and culture in a safe environment. And that's what we wanted to do. Our community is really divided. We are the largest ethnic community in the world without a country of our own. And I will show you how our country is divided among many places. So when we come to Canada, we bring those divisions with us, unfortunately. And for us, faith brings us together. The culture brings us together too. And how we would be able to take the opportunity for us to unite them using embracing faith and culture, we felt that it's really important for us to find the space to be able to do that. And we thought, let's start with Ramadan, because that's the month of fasting when, for us, we believe that all of the Satans and devils are chained. So when is the best time to practice, actually, to bring people together when the evils are not there to divide us? So that's what we did. For us, the foundation, we just started it, so basically it's brand new. it's led by volunteer board members, and I have my colleagues here, Amjad, Ayub, Adam, Adiba, and Ali and Ihsan. And we have a couple other board members who couldn't join us today, but we got together and we felt that there is a need for us to do it. We don't receive any funding from anywhere. We rely on donations from some of our board members and some of the colleagues from the community who have been coming forward. Of course, we bring together members of the Kurdish community from all parts of Kurdistan, and I will explain it in a bit. We offered iftar during Ramadan. So iftar is, as Rana mentioned, is when we break the fast, we share a meal with each other. And we have been really blessed. For all of our events that we did, we've had more than 100 people joining and using the space. So people, kids running around with some of you and when you joined us, but they give us joy because that's what we wanted to do. And then, of course, we had young, the elderly, and everybody else joining us as well. Of course, the other thing that's really important for us is the Friday prayers. So we were all overcome with emotions doing the first Jumu'ah in Kurdish here in Canada. And, you know, it's something really we felt proud of being able to do. We are really hoping as we go forward to do seminars on topics related to Islam and the Kurdish community as well. We are planning to do language and faith classes for children, and I'm really glad that you guys will allow us to continue using the space going forward. Thank you. So our board members, I already introduced them, they are here. A little bit about Kurds and Kurdistan. So this is the map, and this is God brought us in a place where all the trouble is. It's the Middle East. So unfortunately, from World War I to World War II and then beyond, I would like to share a story with you. I fled in during the 90s when the Gulf War started and there was internal fighting. I fled twice, once and I went back because I really didn't want to continue being a refugee. And then the second time, I couldn't go back. So I came to Canada during the Saddam Hussein regime, and when I arrived in Canada, I was really debating where home is. I was always thinking of going back when things changed, and it took a really long time. And then in 2003, Saddam Hussein was toppled, and I thought, it's my opportunity to go back. I couldn't, because I couldn't connect anymore. There were some certain things, and I couldn't believe that stability would continue there. And I remember in 2005, my late dad, I was having a chat with him, and he said, I think it's time for you to come back. And I reflected back, I said, I'm struggling with that, because from the time that I remember, this area has been in war and fighting. Maybe 1 year of stability, but then it continued to happen again. And he said, oh no, son, it's actually from the time that I remember. It has been in war, and he was born in 1980. So you can imagine, and he continued to be troubled. So unfortunately, our land is from that area. During World War II, when the Ottoman Empire collapsed and the British and the French came, they decided to divide the region. So our Kurdistan became divided among Syria, Turkey, Iran, and Iraq. These four countries, they fight each other all the time. The only thing that they agree on is to persecute the Kurds. Unfortunately, that's the case. So we've been really divided. We have families, the border separate them. And I remember one of the persons working with me when I was working with the Iraqi opposition back in Kurdistan. He got married to his cousin. We are allowed, by the way, to get married to our first cousin. So he got married to his first cousin, and his first cousin happened to be in the Turkish side of Kurdistan. So for him, it's a walking distance. He could go to that village, but if he takes a visa, he would need months to be able to travel there, because it would take him forever. He has to go from Baghdad to Istanbul at the time, and then travel all the way back down there. So I told him, how did you do? He said, he just walked across the border, smuggled in, got married, brought his wife, smuggled in again, and then that's how. And unfortunately, that's the story of the Kurds. So that's our region, it's divided. This is our flag of Kurdistan. It's only recognized in Iraq right now. In other parts, they hate it. If you carry it, you might be in trouble. And as Kurds, for many years, we were not even allowed to speak our own language. So we were not allowed to say that we are Kurds, especially in the Turkish and some other areas. Many of us were stateless as well in our own lands. So you can only imagine. So as I mentioned, it's divided. The population, we really don't have exact figures. These are all estimates. Because if a country denies us, they would not tell us how many of us are there, so that's a fact. But there are more than 60 million Kurds. Our language is Kurdish, obviously. We speak several dialects, so Surani and Badini, Kurmanji would be the two main ones. Our religion, we are mostly Sunni Muslims, but we have other groups as well, Yazidis, and these were the groups who were enslaved by the terrorist organization in the Middle East recently, Zoroastrianism, Christianity, and of course Alevism are some of the religions there too. The Jewish community in Kurdistan migrated to Israel during the 1940s and 50s, so we don't have a Jewish community right now, but we used to have those as well. So that's us. We have a really rich culture. our clothes are really colorful. We really love colors, and Kurds are really known for their dance and group dance and all this. And it's really beautiful. But today we are not here to discuss it. We have a short time, so we'll go there. In BC, the arrivals in Canada. Basically, the Kurds came on waves, and the waves were from people during the war. So 1970s, when the Kurdish revolution was crushed, many of the youth came. And then during the 80s, there was a campaign by Saddam Hussein. He used chemical weapons and destroyed 5,000 villages, slaughtered 180,000 people. So many people start fleeing as well. And then during the 1990s, when Gulf War started, many people started coming, and they continue to come here as well. So a large population of our community come from refugee background, including myself. Our regions in Canada, Ontario has the largest population of Kurds. Basically in Hamilton, Ontario, Kitchener, and the area there. And in Alberta, we do have a big community as well. BC tend to be the third one when it comes to the population. If you look at Census Canada, it says only there are 16,000 Kurds in Canada. But from the stats, we know that there are way more than this here. So if you look at the census data for 2016, it says that there are 1,435 in BC, and I know more than those. and I remember when the census was done, many people tend not to put their language as Kurdish because on their immigration documents, it might say Farsi or Arabic or Turkish, because in the country where they fled, they were really afraid to say that their first language is Kurdish, or because they couldn't speak the language, so they put down any other language there. Now, unfortunately, it continued even with Citizens Canada. When they were completing it, they would either put down English as their first language, or they would put down the language of the country that they came from. And official estimates, we have more than 5,000 BC, so that's unofficial. Pillars of Islam, I invite my colleague Ihsan to come and talk about it. Rona, please tell us when our time is up, because we tend to speak a lot.
Thank you. Thanks for inviting us. I'd like to start with a remark, actually. I couldn't help myself just but to realize and see and feel it for myself, at least. When she was preaching and giving the real sincere conversation, and I saw her eyes full with tears, I couldn't help myself just to be the same, and also to reflect and remember certain verses in Quran that talks about the sincerity as well as the humility of Christians. Quran talks about the sincerity as well as the humility of Christians, and Quran says that the Christians are the closest to you, to Muslims. So I really felt that. I just wanted to share that. Thank you. So I'd like to, thanks for the presentation. My part is the pillars of Islam. Just to make it simple and easy, like the fingers of our hand, we have five pillars of Islam. The first one, which starts with the Shahada, which means the witnessing that there's only one God, the Creator, and then the second part of it is witnessing that Muhammad is the messenger, is the last messenger of Allah. Then the second important part comes, which is Salah, the prayer. Again, we pray five times a day. Then the third pillar of Islam is zakat, or almsgiving. Every Muslim who is not below poverty level has to pay certain amount of their income or the wealth they have annually to certain group of people, basically the poor people. Then the fourth one, which is the one we are just ending, which is Ramadan. Saum means fasting, which is like fasting for the entire month of Ramadan. And the fifth pillar is Hajj, or pilgrimage, which is an obligation on any Muslim able to do so, both physically and financially, to go to Mecca once in his or her lifetime. So the first one, this is the first pillar of Islam, or the most important one, and this is the key to enter Islam. Basically, if you just say that and believe in it, then you are a Muslim. You don't have to, but that's how it works. So it just says that I bear witness that there is no God, basically monotheism, one God, and Muhammad is his messenger. Then the second pillar, which is the obligatory, 2.5% of one's holdings after 1 year has passed on the wealth, every Muslim has to pay to these groups. We pay to those groups without going into details, but generally the poor people, those who are in debt or those who can't make their ends meet, we pay to those people. Whether they are relatives, neighbors, it doesn't matter. And these are paid by the people. We don't give it to the pastor or to the mullah or to the Muslim leader. So we have like decentralized power in dividing or contributing this zakat. Exactly, not to your family members, so that there's no conflict of interest. So you're not using it. Just to bypass the corruption. And zakat, the literal meaning means purifying. So by paying this amount of alms or this charity to poor people, you are purifying your act, your deed, your wealth, because of many bad things that might have gone wrong or happened. The third pillar of Islam, which is the second most important one after witnessing Shahada, is the Salat, which means prayer. Salat, the literal meaning of the Arabic word, means relationship or link between us and God. And we pray five times a day. The first one, which is Fajr, before the sunrise. And then we have one in noon, and then afternoon, then one evening by the sunset, and lastly before going to bed, or 1 hour after evening. Then another pillar is fasting, which basically means the month of Ramadan, and that's the clear verse from Quran talking about fasting. All who you have believed, fasting is prescribed to you as it was prescribed to those before you, that you may learn self-restraint. And here the mention is to people who were before us, meaning Christians and Jews, who were also asked to fast. And fasting is in the ninth month of the Islamic or the Arabic calendar, which is basically a lunar calendar. And fasting simply means abstaining from any food or drink or any sexual activity from the dawn till the sunset. Of course, that also includes refraining from any bad deeds, like bad mouthing, talking about people, fighting with other people. We have a clear hadith or saying from our Prophet. He says, when you are fasting and someone tells you something bad, you just ignore him or her. Or even if they fight, you just say, I'm fasting. Means I'm restraining myself from any reaction or bad activities. And of course, it's a month that we are highly encouraged to be more merciful, to be more helpful to our neighbors and people, and be more generous. There are some exceptions for fasting. Of course, children don't have to fast till they become teenagers. And then if you are sick, you don't have to fast. Breastfeeding women on their period, they don't have to fast, as well as the elderly. And if you are traveling, then there's exception for you not to fast and then to fast later on. The final one is the pilgrimage. Muslims, male and female, are required to go on a journey of pilgrimage by dedicating a portion of their time and energy to go to Mecca, which is now in Saudi Arabia, once in their lifetime. And of course, if they are able, both physically and financially. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. I will now invite Ahmad and Ayub, for both of them to come here. If there are any questions, maybe one or two, and then of course we'll be around. Is that okay, Ron?
Journey 3 verse 16, the Bible says, Someone who believes in Jesus Christ as the Son of God, he will not die. He will have eternal life. Jesus Christ came to this world to save a sinners like you, like me, who believe to him is saved. But me, I am very excited to listen that someone who is not written in the Bible or in the beginning of God, of creation, as you follow the five books for Moses. But I'm excited to listen that Jesus Christ, you take him as one. Because for God showed that Muhammad is under of Jesus. Jesus is high for everyone. What is God?
Can I answer this?
Everyone Jesus is the same, it's the same as Muhammad.
Okay.
Is
it okay? In Islam, we say they're all together. They're all messengers of God. And in the Bible, I believe there's somewhere it says, if I cannot give you everything right now, I can't tell you everything right now because you cannot handle it. He's the one who will be coming and give you, and he's the one, the spirit, and he's the one who will finish the message. So we believe that Muhammad is the one who came and finishing the message and tells us that what the left from the message from God. That's what we believe in. And in Islam, they're all the same. We always believe they're all the same. And there's a verse in the Quran that says that, but when Jesus felt the disciples from them, he said, disbelievers from them, he said, who are supporters for Allah, that the disbelieved, the disciples said, we are supporters of Allah. We have believed in Allah and testified that we are Muslim. Islam, it means submission to God. It doesn't mean you have to be from Middle East or you have to be from somewhere that particular, that place only, or you speak that language only. Islam, it just the meaning is means that you submit to God. That's what Islam is. And just want to thank you for the church for the opportunity to be here and give us the space to come here. It reminds me there's a one time happened in Islam that Muslim could not stay in Mecca. The Prophet Muhammad asked them to leave and go to Habasha. Right now it's called Ethiopia. There's a king, he's a Christian. If you get there, you will never be rejected. You will never be sent back anywhere. He will give you safe heaven. So this is, we feel it the same way. We ask you and we got it from you. Thank you very much.
Hello everyone. My name is Ayub. Thank you very much for your time. I don't know if there's any questions, but I just want to share, please.
Can I ask you a question?
Absolutely. Okay, as long as she's not going to kick us out.
First question is, I'm adopted with two dads, and I know that Unity supports gay and queer rights, and so I'm just wondering if the Kurdish community, in regards to Muslim support LGBTQ rights, I'm just wondering where you guys stand.
We stand where Muslims stand. I mean, I know we're very divided, as it appears to be. Anybody who created by God is respected in our perspective. So is the Kurdish community, because we're coming from the Sunni nation. So anything that you hear from the Muslims, technically we have to follow as long as it comes from God. When it comes to the LGBTQ community, so any other specialties in life that you were born with, believe me, we were born with a lot of trauma in our land at that time, so our speciality actually even much more difficult to deal with. We believe that Islam respects you as long as you respect others. We believe that whatever speciality or special cases or anything that you believe that is different from everybody, which is not so much different anymore, it's just part of the life, the way we're born and the way you like. as you don't annoy around you, as long as you do you're not becoming a bad influence around your community, bad influence in a very large mean, then you're free. We believe that LGBT community are people. They're created by God, they're respected. What they believe, but what they do in their own private lives, it matters to them and between their God. That's what we believe in. What's going to happen after death? Where are they going to go? That's not our place. This is the job for God. Simple as that. Anything that they tell you after that is their own opinion. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that's a pretty beautiful way of putting it.
No worries.
Seven. So we haven't asked them to fast, and they are not religiously obliged to fast because they are underage. I mean, they are not teenagers. But they just find it joyful to wake up like 4 a.m. in the morning and eat with us an early breakfast and then go to school. And we still pack food and water for them in their backpack, and they take it to school. And we ask them, I mean, you have freedom. We don't force them to break it, but you still have food in case just you felt thirsty or hungry. And my daughter, she's very adamant and she's like strong, she doesn't break it. But my son, when he comes home and by afternoon, oh, what happened? Are you fasting? He says, no, I was so hungry and thirsty, I couldn't wait. So, I mean, that's how it is. But they are not required to do so.
Yeah.
Thank
you. Yeah, well, actually, the only thing probably we missed in the presentation is that one of the nicknames of Islam is actually the completer. They call Islam Mukammil, the religion of Mukammil, which means the completer. Because technically, we believe that if you're Muslim, you're a better Christian. If you're Muslim, you're better Jewish. We believe that this message came to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, as a completer. So if you look into Quran, half of it is about Christians. Talks about Jesus, talks about Mary, talks about how the stories went, and then Musa and his family, and Zechariah and his family, basically the Jew and Bani Israel, the children of Israel. So the story of Kaaba, the house that was built by Prophet Ibrahim, which we respect and we believe in so strongly, and we count as a Jewish and the Christianity and Islam as Ibrahimic religions, the people that they've got the book from the same God. If we do not believe those three religions, we're not a proper Muslim. The story of that house that's been built by Prophet Ibrahim, whatever you see in TV about Hajj actually is not really related to Muslims so much. It's related to the history before Muslims. The stuff that we do, the between the two lakes, it's really both are coming from the history of Ibrahim. That house was built by Ibrahim, and at that time there was no life there. But God commanded him and he did it. And then there's a water there, the holy water, we call it Zamzam, which roughly translates to English means stop, stop. Zamzam means stop, stop, because it was like pouring out while the wife of Prophet Ibrahim was running around to seek for water for Ishmael, his, her son. That running around, that struggle, that communication with God, and all of a sudden God tells him to behead his son, and then right in the middle where he's about to do it, he says, like, okay, stop, you command. We know that you're serious. And that was the whole concept. And then Ishmael was saved. So the whole concept of Hajj and that spot in the world actually is not related to Muslims so much. More than it's related to the history that where Ibrahim comes up to Muhammad, peace be upon him. Any other? Sure.
I didn't understand very well about Muhammad. Because if you believe someone, for us a Christian, we believe in Jesus Christ. Because anytime you say his name,
right,
you say his name, Jesus, mm-hmm. the soul, you know that person is made by three things, soul, body, and the spirit. Mm-hmm. But when you say Jesus, and you believe to him, you are saved.
So you're trying to tell me that Jesus is God?
But I want to know.
Because I'm having a difficulty understanding your question. Sorry?
Who is Muhammad?
Muhammad is the messenger of God.
Why do you believe him as a...
So, we are an inclusive group, and we honor every person's right to choose their own belief system. And we believe that there is only one power, and whether you call it the God of the Islamic faith, or whether you call it God of the Jewish faith, or whether you call it God of the Christian faith, we believe that it is one God, and that we're all coming to it from different places. And so, if people have a different understanding of Jesus than what is a traditional understood Christian belief, which is the Christian belief is that Jesus is the one and only Son of God. That is the traditional version of Christianity, and that Jesus came to die because we are all sinners. Well, not everyone who is on the Christian spectrum believes that version of Christianity either. And so we want to be able to acknowledge not just the wisdom of other faith traditions, but also that there is a spectrum within Christianity as well of people who believe that we are sinners, all the way to a place where we believe that we are human, and sometimes we do things that aren't so pleasant as humans, but that we're all still part of God, and that God expresses through us and as us, because there is no spot that God is not. And so it may be a slightly different understanding that you might be comfortable with, and I'm going to encourage you to be open to that as well, because we're all one, and our goal is to move into a place where we all raise in consciousness, the consciousness of love and connection and appreciation for each other, because God doesn't make this.
See ourselves as sinners. We were born as pure. We do sin. Of course, God loves sinners to be repented and people to say sorry to him. But when we were born, we're clear as pure. And the difference that you see it, because the typical idea about Christians is that Jesus came to save us because we're all screwed up. And pretty much, because we believe that God is the only savior in our religion. The people that they come from God, Jesus, Moses, Abraham, Muhammad, they're just the guides. They're people like us. In fact, a lot of scholars in Islam believe that Muhammad was a normal human being until he was 40. And his law, his lifestyle does not apply as a prophet. Whatever he did before that, he was a human being. So whenever he's communicating with God with a message, he's the prophet. And that's a concept of the moment you were born and stepped into this life, you're in trouble. Already, we don't really necessarily get into that loop. But again, at the end, by the time you die, you've done a bunch of stuff, so you're going to need the mercy of God, and definitely your deed and whatever you've done to please Him is not enough. So technically you need His mercy and Savior, and the guide will help you, of course. So is the old prophets. Am I going all right? Okay.
Unfortunately divided us humans in so many ways. And so if we can expand our cloak, I'm busy writing a story, you know, a wall's going tick-tock, but I'm writing a story at the moment, or writing a chapter about the story of the new patch on an old cloak. And I've been struggling a little bit about what else this could mean. And I realize that what it could mean also is that we, who are sometimes the old cloak, need to expand ourselves so that we can welcome a new idea, something that we didn't consider, without rending things apart. And we create something new and beautiful and diverse and stunning. Okay, Walt, are you trying to get my attention?
I'm sorry, I can't leave this without a comment, and that is
tell us a surprise
that we are not here today to challenge or question our beliefs. We are here to celebrate the things that we have in common.
Yeah. Well, this is true, that we are celebrating the things that we have in common. And it's also true that it is absolutely a safe place to ask questions so that we can get to some answers and make it so that we can continue. All are welcome, including the uncomfortable questions. So thank you. Let's stand and sing this song, which you all know is my theme song. The reason we're picking it is because it's easy to follow along and it's absolutely universal.
In the morning of my life, I shall look to the sunrise. At a moment in my life when the world is new, and the blessing I shall
service announcement up. It is great. We are, that was perfect. I don't know. Thanks, Catherine. For those who may not hear that on the recording, it was one of those bird chirping sounds. That's awesome. So on Mondays between 10:30 and 11:15, you are all welcome to join us on Zoom for a time of prayer and meditation. It is a time where we reset, where we have a chance to meditate and become centered again, and also a time where we name all the people whose names are on our prayer list. And so it is a time which is connecting and also restoring. And so join us if you are able to. Jim, we were going to have a birthday party for Jim. He just turned 92. And he is requesting that we wait for a few weeks, maybe a month or two, because he wants to work on walking. He, at the moment, he is in a place where his legs are not supporting his weight. And he would wants to work on getting himself mobile again before he has his birthday celebration. And so we do have a birthday card, which I think is still in my purse. And so I will get that sent around and after the service. If you would like to, please just sign a card for him. A medicine wheel labyrinth is coming along. So talk about another center for inclusion here. And what we're doing with this medicine wheel labyrinth is going to be on the right-hand side as you leave the fellowship hall, the place where nothing would ever grow. So it's like, okay, what else can we do? Okay, let's do this. And so on Saturday, May the 14th, Saturday, May the 14th at 10 o'clock, we will be starting the work of digging the foundation, digging to create space for the foundation to be laid. We need to get 4 inches down and that entire area ready for the concrete work that needs to be done. And so, before we begin though, we are going to have a ceremony to consecrate the ground. And we are working on getting the right people here to make that happen. So we'll have a little ceremony first to bless this project. And then bring your shovels, and bring your grimy clothes, and bring gloves and tarps and wheelbarrows and whatever else you might have so that we can do that work on that day. And I have a wedding to do that afternoon, so cheers. But we're going to also make that into a beautiful experience and a work party. So we'll make sure that there's coffee and munchies and food, and it'll be fun. So please keep that date, May the 14th at 10 o'clock. Also, the GoFundMe is nearing $1,000. And so if you could please share that information with your friends, with your family, all you need to do is to follow the link in the email that I sent out yesterday and this morning, or go to GoFundMe and then search Unity Medicine Wheel Labyrinth and it will show up there. And speaking of labyrinth and GoFundMe and fundraising, this is Mr. Lyle at work creating a star blanket. And this blanket has been created from all the donations of denim that he's received from here and many other places. I don't even want to think about how many hours of work have gone into creating this beautiful work of art. It is queen size, it'll fit a queen size bed, or it can be used as a wall hanging. And we expect that sometime in the next while, we will use this as a fundraiser for the labyrinth, very likely a silent auction. But Lyle, this is absolutely amazing. It's so beautiful. And my screenshot that I took the other day does not capture it at all. So very grateful for you. So thank you. And so while we're on the subject of gratitude, thank you all for your contributions to this ministry. both in finances, but also in time and in talent. There is such richness in this community, and we are so, so grateful. And many of you are people who have donated and set up recurring contributions. In fact, I think almost everybody now is doing that. And I want to express how deeply grateful me and the rest of our board are for that, because it just makes the running of this beautiful community so much more smooth when we can kind of count on the bills being able to be paid. So thank you, thank you. I invite you now to hold whatever you are grateful for in your hearts and in your minds as we sing our blessing song. We are so blessed.
Masks on.
Thank you.